begin, I would like to start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to introduce my colleagues who serve on the New Hampshire Executive Council and discuss the ground rules for today's proceedings. From Executive Counselor for District 1, Joseph Kenny; Executive Counselor for District 2, Cindy Warmington; Executive Counselor for District 4, Ted Gatzis; Executive Counselor for District 5, Dave Wheeler. Following Mr. Formella's opening statement, each executive counselor will be given the opportunity to ask questions. Additionally, those wishing to testify, either for or against, will be given 3 to 5 minutes to speak. Following public testimony, if there are any additional questions from council members, they will be given the opportunity to do so at the conclusion of public testimony. Mr. Formella, congratulations on your nomination to serve as Attorney General, and thank you for stepping up to serve all New Hampshire residents, something which you've been doing for 4 years as legal counsel to Governor Sununu. The Attorney General for New Hampshire is deemed the top law enforcement official for the state of New Hampshire and serves as the head of New Hampshire's Department of Justice, responsible for a staff currently of 166, with a pending budget request to go up to 175, a budget for 21, which was in excess of $43 million, 15 bureaus and units. Your responsibilities of the Attorney General are broad, expansive, critical, and essential to protecting all citizens of New Hampshire. With that, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Councillor, and good morning to all the councillors. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today and for the conversations we've had over the past couple of weeks. I'm honored to be sitting before you as the governor's nominee to serve as the next Attorney General of the state of New Hampshire. The prospect of serving as our state's Attorney General, as the state's attorney, as the people's ultimate advocate and the protector of the public, is for me the public service opportunity of a lifetime. I can say from working closely with many of the attorneys and staff of the Department of Justice over the past 4 years that there are many talented and energetic people at the department who are in public service for the right reasons. I've really enjoyed working with them over the past 4 years from across the street, and I'd be honored to join them in the office. Before I go further, I'd be remiss if I didn't offer some acknowledgement and thanks. First, I of course have to thank the governor for the confidence he's placed in me with this nomination. Next, I have to thank my family, my dad, John, brother, Paul, sister-in-law, Mary, and nephew, Brooks, who are all listening in, and my mom, who we lost all too soon last year, but who I know is somewhere smiling and here with me in spirit. I'd also like to thank the colleagues I've worked with for the past 4 years, both in the governor's office and throughout state government. And of course, I have to thank my former colleagues at Pierce Adler, the firm where I began my legal career. I think it's safe to say I would not be here today without any of them. And finally, I just want to thank in advance everyone who's come here today or dialed in to support my nomination and all those who have wished me well over the past 2 weeks. Like many in our state, I'm not a New Hampshire native, but I have been a New Hampshire resident now for most of my life. I was born in Rochester, Minnesota, and spent the early years of my childhood in Jacksonville, Florida. When I was 12, we moved to Hanover, New Hampshire, where I graduated from high school in 2004. After high school, I attended college at Florida State University, where I graduated magna cum laude and Phi Beta Kappa with a bachelor's degree in English, and later with a master's degree in applied American politics and policy. I then attended law school at George Washington University, where I graduated with honors and served as a member of the International Law Review. To truly give you a sense of who I am, I have to tell you a bit about the two most influential people in my life. My parents, John and Nancy. My dad was a truck driver when my parents met, though he later went back to school and became an engineer and worked at IBM until retirement. I think I have to say my dad's years as a truck driver had much more of an influence on me than his years as an engineer, because I maintain a love of road trips, country music, and truck stop food to this day, and I think anyone who knows me will tell you I'm one of the least technologically savvy people you will ever meet. My dad's quiet dedication to our family and unwavering support to everything that we have tried to do over the years is what got me here today. My mom was a trailblazer who rose to senior leadership positions in the healthcare industry, an industry like most in which leadership continues to be overwhelmingly dominated by men. But she taught us more about faith, family, and fight in her personal challenges than anything she achieved throughout her career. As I mentioned, my mom passed away in January of last year after a 7-month battle with brain cancer. But she was a fighter to the end. In the middle of her chemo and radiation treatments, mom graduated with her doctorate in nursing practice, achieving a lifelong dream in the midst of tragedy. It was her toughness and a deep abiding faith that allowed her to persevere and mark this achievement. I will never forget standing by her side and lifting her up at her graduation to receive her degree in academic good. If confirmed, I will carry my mom's strength and the faith inherited from both of my parents into the role of Attorney General. The role of Attorney General is, without a doubt, one of the most important positions in our state. The Attorney General and the Department of Justice has broad responsibilities that span a number of disciplines. While no person could check every box from a qualifications perspective, I do believe that my experience in the public and private sectors makes me uniquely qualified to assume this role. I began my legal career in the private practice of law at Pierce Adler in the firm's Portsmouth, New Hampshire office. Right out of the gate, I took and passed 3 bar exams in 3 different states so that I could practice in New Hampshire, Maine, and Massachusetts. And I practiced in all 3 of those states in the firm's environmental and business practice groups. As part of the firm's business practice group, I worked on various matters, but I focused on mergers and acquisitions. Through this work, I learned to manage large and complicated transactions in high stakes and time-sensitive environments. As part of the environmental practice group, I assisted clients of all types, large and small, with a variety of environmental law issues, including compliance, permitting, enforcement, litigation and appeals, legislation and rulemaking. In this work, I had the opportunity to work with and assist the regulated community on the opposite side of government, which is a perspective that I think is critical for anyone looking to take a position that exercises regulatory authority. In 2017, I moved on to the public sector after being asked by then-Governor Alex Sununu to serve as his legal counsel. I've served in that role since the governor's first day in office on January 5th, 2017. As governor's counsel, I've been involved in almost every major issue facing the state, legal or otherwise, and I've worked closely with the Department of Justice on a day-to-day basis. Though I've been at the center of many important issues over the past 4 years, one of course stands out. For the past year, I've been at the governor's side playing a key role in assisting him with developing and directing the state's response to the COVID-19 pandemic. This public health crisis presented all of us in state government with challenges for which there is no modern precedent. There was no playbook. Both I and the Department of Justice have wrestled with legal questions for which there were very few modern cases to guide us. To be sure, not everyone has agreed with our conclusions and legal analysis on every issue, but leadership requires making tough choices in the most challenging times, even when you know that some will not agree with you and may even vocally oppose you or take you to court. I've lived this reality during the last 4 years, and I'm prepared to confront these types of decisions if I'm confirmed to be the state's attorney general. As our last attorney general, I'd like to remind everyone, the attorney general really has 5 jobs, and boy, did he love to remind everyone of that. I spent considerable time reflecting on my experience and how it would qualify me for each part of this role before putting my name forward as a candidate. I'd like to share some of those thoughts with you today. First, the Attorney General serves as the state's chief legal officer. In this role, the Attorney General, among other things, represents the state in state and federal court And under RSA 78 advises all state departments and officials on legal questions and works to ensure that they comply with the law. As the governor's counsel, I've worked closely with the Department of Justice on all major litigation affecting the state. I've convened and led countless meetings to discuss legal issues facing state agencies and to discuss litigation strategy. I've appeared on the governor's behalf before the legislature and state boards and commissions numerous times. And I've worked closely with the Attorney General and the Department of Justice to answer complicated legal questions and solve vexing problems facing state agencies. As Chief Legal Officer, the Attorney General, as you know, also serves as counsel to the governor and counsel. And as you all also know, I've attended almost every governor and council meeting for the last 4 years. Like the Department of Justice, I'm also responsible for reviewing all items on the governor and council agenda and assisting with legal issues or other issues that may arise. As I think about this, I think, just to put it simply, I'm well prepared to serve as the state's chief legal officer. Second, the Attorney General serves as the chief law enforcement officer. Over the last 4 years, I've advised the governor on issues involving law enforcement and the criminal justice system. And I've served as the governor's primary liaison to the law enforcement community and the state's Department of Safety. I've worked closely with the state's law enforcement agencies on the implementations of the LEAC Commission's recommendations. That's a commission the governor established in June of last year. And I've had to brief the governor on law enforcement events in real time. Thus, I'm confident that I have the necessary background to transition into the role of the chief law enforcement officer. Third, the Attorney General serves as the state's chief prosecutor. This is the area in which the Attorney General operates most independently from the rest of the executive branch, and my experience in this area is therefore admittedly limited. Fortunately, the Department of Justice is known for having some incredible talent in its criminal bureau. With these attorneys as a resource, and my past experience having to learn and digest complicated issues in short periods of time, I'm confident that with hard work and utilization of the knowledge of existing department staff, that I'll be able to quickly come up to speed and develop the skills necessary to serve as the state's chief prosecutor. Fourth, the Attorney General leads the Department of Justice and thus serves as a department head akin to a commissioner. A department head is responsible for, among other things, managing staff, setting a direction for the department, developing a budget, working with other commissioners and department heads, and advocating for his or her department before the legislature and the governor and council. In my position as governor's counsel, I'm one of only, I would say, a few people in state government who has broad statewide experience on all aspects that a department head is responsible for. I have significant experience with the state budget, having played a key role in the development of 3 governor's proposed operating budgets. I've assisted the governor with various personnel matters related to staff in the governor's office and across state agencies. And I've worked with almost every commissioner and department head on multiple issues. And of course, when it comes to vision, for the past 4 years, I've been helping the governor develop a vision not just for one department, but the entire executive branch. With this in mind, I believe I do have the background and experience necessary to take on the job of managing the Department of Justice. And finally, the Attorney General serves as the ultimate protector of the public. I think this is a role that perhaps encompasses the job more than anything. At the end of the day, the Department of Justice is the people's law firm. And as we know, there are a lot of people in the state who don't have access to legal representation or don't know where to go when they have issues. And so in a lot of ways, I think this is the most profound role of the department. During the past 4 years, I've worked with the department on major public protection issues, and these include lawsuits brought against companies who are responsible for distributing or manufacturing or prescribing opioids improperly and fueling the opioid crisis, and also corporations that are responsible for polluting our environment. I've also worked with victims of fraud in the legislative process and in a constituent service role, and I can say that when you talk to people who have been victims of fraud or other types of abuses and they have nowhere else to turn, it can be very difficult. There's sometimes nothing you can do to help them other than refer them to whatever resources may be available. So I think I have a perspective on the public protection role that the department plays. In addition to its specific public protection functions, the Attorney General is at times called upon to bring forth action in the name of the state in unique circumstances. A prime example of this is when the state took historic action last year to bring a lawsuit against the state of Massachusetts for imposing Massachusetts income taxes on New Hampshire remote workers. We brought this case as an original jurisdiction action in the United States Supreme Court, and I've been working closely with the Department of Justice on all aspects of that case. To sum it up, I think in thinking about the five different roles of the Attorney General and reflecting on those, I think it's clear when you look at my experience that I've got what it takes and the skills necessary to serve as the state's Attorney General. Before I close, I'd like to just speak briefly about a few commitments that I'll make to the council and to the public if I am confirmed. This is by no means exhaustive. This list is by no means exhaustive. First, I will work every day to preserve the independence and the integrity of the office. Perhaps more than ever before, the Attorney General really must stand out as an objective, neutral, and reasoned voice that advises our state leaders on the requirements of the law and puts the interests of the public above all else. As Attorney General, my only loyalty will be to the law and the public interest, period. Second, as the state's chief law enforcement officer, I start from the premise from my experience during the past 4 years that New Hampshire's law enforcement are second to none. We have a proud tradition of integrity, professionalism, and community engagement among the 5,000 men and women who keep us safe. I will advocate for the resources that law enforcement needs to perform their duties, and I will work with other leaders in the law enforcement community to hold those accountable when they hold officers accountable if they fall short and help them be better. This will include working with both law enforcement and community leaders to implement the recommendations of the LEAD Commission in a manner that works for law enforcement and the community as a whole. Third, I will work to make sure that the department makes constituent and client service a top priority. We will work to create better and efficient avenues by which the public can communicate with the department. And we'll hold ourselves to the highest standards in service and responsiveness to all, including the governor, the council, state agencies, the legislature, and most importantly, the public. Fourth, I'm committed to maintaining the department's reputation for excellence and fostering an environment in which all attorneys and staff have opportunities to grow and advance. In recent years, we've seen attorneys from the department go on to lead state agencies, serve on the bench, and develop thriving practices in the public sector. If I'm confirmed, I'll consider it my obligation to help those who excel in the department move on to new opportunities in other areas of state government or in the private sector, if they wish to do so. I think it's by providing these opportunities for advancement that we can recruit the best and brightest to work for the department and to provide the best service possible for state government and the public. And finally, I make what is perhaps my most important commitment. If I'm confirmed as Attorney General, I will, as my predecessors did before me, work tirelessly to ensure that anyone who harms our state, brings harm to individuals within our state, violates the rights of individuals within our state, or violates our state's laws, will be brought to justice through the criminal process or held accountable through civil action, or both. Under my watch, the Department of Justice will never cease in its mission to deliver justice for our state. Our state's faced many challenges in the last 4 years, and in the next 4 years, we'll face many more, some of which we can't even imagine at this point. But I'm eager to continue the necessary work to meet these challenges, and if I'm confirmed, I will give this job everything I have. Thank you again for the opportunity to discuss my nomination. I look forward to your questions, and I hope to earn your support.
Thank you, Mr. Formella. So proceeding with questions from the Executive Council, we will start with Councillor Dave Wheeler.
Yeah, thank you, Councillor. John, one thing that you didn't talk about in your speech here was election integrity.
Yeah.
So we have a unit at the AG's office to work on that now.
Yeah.
It's my understanding under Gordon McDonald that We have prosecuted several people. So could you say, tell me how that off, what that office is going to look like under your administration should you be confirmed?
Absolutely, Counselor. I think it's important when we think about the Attorney General's role in elections to kind of step back and just think about the different jobs the Attorney General has in that area. It's several. One is to provide counsel to the Secretary of State. Another is to defend the state's election laws when they're challenged. Another is to work with municipalities on providing advice to them and assistance with administering elections, because they're the front lines of our elections here in New Hampshire. And the fourth, which is just as important as the rest, is the fair and impartial enforcement of our election laws. And I think that that's a critical component. So as you mentioned, we've had a number of prosecutions the last few years. I understand that the last Attorney General, I think he stated publicly that there are some others in the pipeline. And if I'm confirmed and if I'm Attorney General, we will continue to prosecute those cases where we find them and take violations of our election laws very seriously. I think it's important for a couple reasons. One is that in a state where we have elections that are decided by one or two votes, even a few instances of improper voting are a problem. And the second is that confidence in our election system is also important. And I think people need to see that if anyone is violating our election laws, that they're being held accountable. So I'll continue to take that very seriously. I'll take a look at what we've been doing in the last few years, and to the extent there is an opportunity to enhance that, I'll definitely look to take advantage of it.
To follow up on that, so what would what do you think the Attorney General's role is in the Wyndham situation? There has been some criticism that the Attorney General's office wasn't responsive enough.
Yeah. So my understanding from the last AG and also folks over there is that it was their opinion, and I won't second guess that opinion, but their opinion that under the law as it is, they really didn't have an ability to go in and take another look at what happened in Wyndham now that the results have been certified. But I know that they've been providing some technical assistance to the legislature on a bill that's made its way through the Senate, was passed unanimously in the Senate, it's making its way through the House, that would give the office and the Secretary of State authority to conduct an audit of the state representative race in Wyndham. I think that's important so that we can see what happened. I think we see bipartisan support for that, given that there was a 9 or 10% variance between the original results and the recount results. So I think the office's role will be to take any authority that the legislature gives it with regard to that matter, carry it out, and conduct the audit.
Thank you. That's no further questions at this time.
Mr. Gatzes.
I'll wait until you ask. Thank you.
Once again, congratulations on your nomination.
Thank you, Counselor.
After being sworn into office 7 days ago, we've had the opportunity to discuss a myriad of issues affecting my constituents. Your support for District 3 has been appreciated. So once again, congratulations on your nomination.
Thank you, Counselor.
After being officially sworn into office 70 days ago, we've had the opportunity to discuss a myriad of issues affecting my constituents. Your support for District 3 has been appreciated. In your opening statements, you stated that the Attorney General is the ultimate protector of the public. In my situation, you have stepped up for those who have experienced catastrophic losses, for those who do not have a voice. The most vulnerable are children, and your support has been appreciated. So over the past few weeks, the focus has shifted to your nomination, and more specifically, your experience and your vision for the Department of Justice. If you are confirmed to serve as the next Attorney General, I'd like to start with some questions regarding environmental issues. New Hampshire has been hit disproportionately hard by groundwater contamination from emerging contaminants of concern. The Environmental Protection Bureau is charged with protection and enforcement of New Hampshire resources. The work is exemplary. For example, the MTBE suit, a settlement for $276 million, was reached in 2016. The Bureau and DES reached a $2.7 million settlement in October of 2020 involving groundwater contamination in Madbury as a result of hazardous waste disposal. There are two significant lawsuits pending in Superior Court. A suit comparable to one of New Hampshire's pending cases recently settled for $850 million in the state of Minnesota. We also have a complaint filed against Monsanto for PCB contamination. My question is, will you sustain the efforts of this Bureau? You've requested a staff increase from 166 to 175. Has a determination been made on where additional staff will be placed? How will you bolster this Bureau?
Thank you for the question, Counselor. Just to start, I'd say I definitely agree that these are critical issues, and I think the fact that I'm coming in at least with some background in environmental law helps. First, we will absolutely continue to vigorously prosecute the cases against 3M and other defendants for PFAS contamination and Monsanto and other defendants for PCBs. I think those cases are really important. We want to move them forward. And coming out of COVID, I think it'll be important to try to move some of these cases that may have, like everything, in all cases in Superior Court have lagged a little bit. So we'll definitely keep a focus on those. You mentioned the budget. I'm in a funny situation because the budget request you referred to is actually the one put in by the previous Attorney General. If I'm confirmed, I'll take a close look at it and see what work maybe we can do with the Senate as far as allocating some additional resources to the Environmental Protection Bureau if needed. So I'll definitely take a look at that. And then, just generally, I think environmental enforcement is important, but I do think it's important to have a balance. I mentioned in my opening testimony that in the private sector, I worked more on the side of the regulated community and not the regulator. And I think you will see some of these cases in which there are real violations, and sometimes I think there is a little bit of overreach on the side of government. So my commitment will be to continue to protect our environment, but to do it in a way that's fair, and to make sure when we seek penalties or anything like that, we're sort of aligning ourselves with past precedent and remembering that on the other side of the case, even though there may be someone who's violated our environmental laws, it's also a business with livelihoods at stake, and we need to keep that in mind. And my experience in the private sector is many times when environmental laws are violated, even when they're serious, it's not always intentional. So I think I'd sum it up by saying I will be committed to continuing to sort of vigorously defend our environment, but to do it with that in mind, that there's a party on the other side of the case, and as the Attorney General, you have obligations to the entire public, so we have to keep that in mind.
So balancing environmental and economic concerns at the same time?
Yes.
Essentially. Multi-state class action suits. New Hampshire has joined the $573 million multi-state settlement with McKinsey & Company. There are additional multi-state settlements, Anthem's Data Breach, CR Bard, and IT&T. These multi-state class action lawsuits in environmental litigation are both labor-intensive. Cost for litigation fees were $1.9 million last year. This was a necessary expenditure. It had to be done. How would you modify the current structure involving these complex cases? Would you seek out a designated attorney who would perhaps oversee these complex cases? How would you proceed?
Yeah, it's an issue that I've heard discussed a number of times in the past few years. I think in talking with the last Attorney General and talking with others who have worked in the department that we need to take a look at potentially hiring either one or two attorneys to focus on multi-state litigation. The reason for that is that it's, you know, many times a state can sign on to one of these lawsuits, but when it comes time to apportion out the recovery, it's states that have served on executive committees for these suits that tend to get a bigger portion. And right now, I don't think the department has the resources to do that. And I think when thinking about the interest of New Hampshire, it would be a great return on investment to have an attorney or two that would be dedicated to multi-state litigation. So I would definitely seek to do that.
Great, thank you. We discussed two fatalities involving children in one of our conversations. The Attorney General's Task Force on Child Abuse and Neglect is responsible for the development of joint investigation protocols between DCYF and law enforcement. These protocols were last updated in 2008, and the release of updated protocols were scheduled for spring of 2020. There is a lot of concern that the delay may mean that the protocol is not entirely up to date, and since we have not seen this draft, we have no idea whether child protection investigations are elevated as a priority that they should be. Protocols require that sharing of information between DCYF and law enforcement when crimes or serious injury occurs. There is an infrastructure of communication and collaboration between DCYF and law enforcement. However, in criminal investigations for prosecution, the protocol does allow for delay of DCYF findings in abuse neglect assessments, a stipulation that potentially leaves children at risk or caseworker out of compliance with case closure timelines. And in one of the cases that we discussed, there were multiple children that were potentially at risk. As the Attorney General, how will you ensure that the new protocols are relevant, up to date, and generally helpful in ensuring children, and in the case of child deaths, surviving siblings are safe and protected?
Thank you for that question, Counselor. I guess I just start by saying that it'll absolutely be a top priority of mine if I'm confirmed. In the past few years, I've worked closely with HHS and the Department of Justice on some of these cases involving just tragic outcomes with abuse and neglect, and I've sat in mediations across from family members who've been affected. So I know the impact that these cases have, and they're devastating. So the commitment I would make is that I would make it a top priority. I would look into the status of the protocols you mentioned and make sure that we get them up to date and we do it quickly and that we don't waste any more time.
Thank you. What is your vision for supporting DCYF in doing its job of investigating child deaths and critical incidents?
I think that it's a little bit related to the last question, right? I mean, I think we need to ensure that there is coordination between DCYF and law enforcement and local authorities. I think a lot of it comes down to communication and coordination. And so at the Department of Justice, I know the Department of Justice provides both legal assistance to DCYF in carrying out its job. And I think if we can do a better job on the front end in providing that type of assistance, we can hopefully avoid having to play as much of the other role, right, which is defending cases brought against DCYF when something doesn't go right. So I think my vision really involves better communication, better coordination, and focusing on getting this right on the front end and not having to defend lawsuits when tragedy happens on the back end.
Lastly, there is an MOU between the Department of Justice and the Department of Health and Human Services to provide supervision and training of DCYF attorneys. How will you support education and training, more specifically in regard to changes in RSA 169, which has expanded and clarified psychological maltreatment? Attorneys within DCYF have been reticent to proceed with going to court, and judges have told us they rarely, if ever, see these cases. So I guess your investment in educating the DCYF attorneys.
Yeah, I think it's hard for me to put a number on it, not being that familiar with the details, but you know, this, I know this MOU exists, and I, like I said, we're going to make this a priority. So I can't tell you necessarily number of people, dollars that we'll put towards it, but it will be a top priority. And I know it's, that some of these cases are tough, right? And attorneys at DCYF, they're not always sure or comfortable about what cases they're going to bring to court. And I think training is a big part of it, but I also just think it's support. And one thing I will say is that people who go to work for a state agency like DCYF they don't do it for the money. Obviously, they're not very well paid. They do it because it's very important work, and the morale over there now, I know, sometimes takes a hit because of the tragedy we've seen in the papers. So I think it's support, not just from a legal and a training perspective, but just support from the perspective that they know that we've got their backs. And we all need to be better. And if we make mistakes, we need to be better. But we're not going to get better if morale at DCYF is low. So.
One final question on the grants management unit. This is critical work. It's a lifeline for many of our 501c3s that have stepped in to disperse care and support to our most vulnerable once again. Do you foresee any changes in how this is managed and operated?
I don't know if I can say whether I foresee any changes other than just to commit that, you know, if I'm confirmed, we'll take a close look at everything. And if there are changes that need to be made to improve it, we will make them. I think one opportunity you have when you come in new is to take a fresh look at everything, put a fresh set of eyes on everything, and not be afraid to make changes that need to be made. If something's been done a certain way for a long time, we can't be afraid to change that if changing it will improve the process. So I commit to making any improvements that need to be made once I get a chance to see where those improvements might be.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. And welcome.
Thank you.
When we spoke, I conveyed to you that I have heard many, many good things about you, that you are respected, you are intelligent, thoughtful, talented, reasonable. I continue to hear many good things and many good qualities about you and the many people who have worked with you. I told you at the time that we spoke that I bet you could guess what concerns people were voicing about this nomination.
Yes.
And you had no trouble identifying the two areas of concern, and that being your level of experience and, of course, whether you could be in this new role as Attorney General, whether you could be independent of the governor. So my questions today will fall primarily in those two areas. Obviously, the New Hampshire Attorney General must be qualified by reason of education and experience for the job. You have been an attorney for 8 years. You served 4 years as an associate in a private law firm and 4 years as governor's counsel. So the Attorney General oversees both criminal and civil matters. So starting with criminal matters, the Attorney General is the top law enforcement official in the state. You'll be responsible for handling homicide cases, overseeing all of the county attorney's offices, providing general supervision over all criminal cases in our state, responsible for training of regional, county, and state prosecutors, conducting criminal investigations, trying criminal cases, handling all criminal appeals to the Supreme Court. So my question to start, have you ever been counsel in a criminal jury trial?
No.
Have you ever been counsel in a criminal bench trial?
No.
Have you ever litigated a motion to suppress?
No.
Have you ever been counsel at an arraignment?
No.
Have you ever done a bail hearing?
No.
Have you ever been counsel in a probable cause hearing?
No.
Have you ever conducted criminal investigation?
I have not.
Have you ever drafted an indictment?
No.
A subpoena?
No.
A search warrant?
No.
Ever been involved in a grand jury proceeding?
No.
Have you ever made a charging decision in a criminal case?
No.
Ever handled plea negotiations in a criminal matter?
No.
Have you ever handled a criminal appeal to the New Hampshire Supreme Court?
No.
To any court?
No.
How would you propose that you would address this lack of experience in the criminal area?
Yeah, I appreciate the question, Counselor. You know, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, my criminal experience is limited. It's really limited more probably to the policy arena, not actually practicing criminal law. To start, I'd say that, you know, I think a lot of the things you just mentioned there involve judgment. And you develop judgment, I think, when you have to have confronted tough decisions, when you have to have looked at issues from different perspectives. I've worked closely with law enforcement on many issues. I've also worked with community groups on many issues related to criminal justice. And I think judgment involves taking a situation, not just analyzing the facts and maybe knowing how to draft an indictment, but being able to see that situation from different perspectives, having a sense of how one person might look at it, but another person who comes from a totally different background might look at it. Seeing that situation, how it might be looked at today or years down the road. So I would start just with relying on my experience, having had the opportunity to work at the highest levels of state government and having had to develop the judgment to confront many tough situations, maybe not in the criminal realm, but in other areas. So I would start with that, just the experience and judgment that I've had to develop in the role I played. Next, I would rely on the experts that are at the Department of Justice. We have some great attorneys, as I mentioned, in our criminal bureau. Deputy Attorney General Jane Young comes out of the criminal world, and she's an expert in that area. Jeff Strelzin, who's the director of the Division of Public Protection, former chief of the Homicide Unit, is very well-versed. Jeff Ward, the head of the Criminal Bureau, Ben Gotti, now the chief of the Homicide Unit. We have some excellent people at the Department of Justice, and I would rely on them. I think I told you when we spoke, one of the most valuable things I think anyone can remember is the quote from Mark Twain, which is that it's not what you don't know that gets you into trouble, it's what you know for sure that just isn't so. I know what I don't know, and I know that this is an area that I will need to come in and rely on experts to draw on my past experiences, seeing the perspectives of law enforcement and community groups, and that's what I'll use as a foundation to develop skills in this area and be able to make the types of decisions you mentioned.
Thank you. Moving on to civil matters, the Attorney General is responsible for providing legal representation in civil matters for all executive branch agencies. It's responsible for regulating charitable trusts, enforcing consumer protection laws, administering and enforcing antitrust laws, investigating and prosecuting disciplinary proceedings before state professional boards, enforcing election laws, and much more. Have you ever been counsel in a civil jury trial?
No.
Have you ever been counsel in a civil bench trial?
No.
Have you ever taken a deposition?
No.
Have you ever filed an appearance in any court in any civil case before a court in our state?
Yes.
In what case?
I have not in the past 4 years, so I'm not sure I can name the case for you, but I have had to do that. It's not typical for the governor's counsel to actually
sure.
appear in cases.
Sure, but when you were in private practice, you filed an appearance.
Yeah, I mean, I one of the things I did was take pro bono cases in small claims. I know I've filed an appearance there. I think, as you know, Counselor, in larger firms, you have a litigation practice group that typically will file appearances in court and go to court, but it doesn't mean the other attorneys in the firm are not working on the litigation or not working on the cases. But I think the answer to your question is yes. I can't recall the name of the case, but yes.
Okay. Thank you. Ever drafted a motion to dismiss?
Yes. I mean, I've been involved in the drafting of motions to dismiss. Yes.
Were they filed under your name as counsel?
No.
Ever filed under your name a motion for summary judgment?
Not filed under my name, technically, no.
Ever filed under your name a motion in limine?
Not filed under my name, no.
Have you ever argued an appeal, a civil case, in any appellate court?
No.
So how would you propose to address your lack of experience in this area?
So I would say this. In private practice, as I mentioned, you know, I did work on the corporate side, which was more transactional mergers and acquisitions. On the environmental side, that definitely involved more matters that were sort of adversarial or advocacy in nature. I think it's known that I've not focused my practice on trial work, but I have had to appear in various advocacy or adversarial roles in other forums. In one example is I've appeared before the legislature and other state boards and commissions multiple times. I've also appeared on behalf of clients in many matters and local land use issues, which can involve very complicated projects, a lot of opposition. I think one thing I just say or ask you to picture is, you know, representing a client, say, who wants to permit a scrapyard in a town, I won't name the town, either Massachusetts, New Hampshire, or Maine, it's one of those three states. And you walk in, may not be court, but you walk in, you're the lawyer, the whole board doesn't like you because they don't like your project. There are 30 or 40 people in the audience who don't like you because they don't like the project. They couldn't care less about the legal arguments you have to make because to them that means nothing. And you as the lawyer have to stand there and try to persuade the board to approve a project. You have the legal tools necessary to do that because your project should be approved under the law, but nobody cares. And I think that you would find that a lot of lawyers in that situation would think to themselves, boy, would this be easier if I were in court, just making legal arguments to a judge. It requires a different type of skill, but it's not dissimilar from court. So I would start by relying on my experience having been in those types of situations. It's not totally dissimilar from being before the legislature. You've got to make legal arguments. I've sat in legislative committees and had to spend hours with a committee answering questions from maybe not an appellate panel, but a panel of many more legislators. And it's not just about the legal arguments you make. It's about being able to distill concepts, make legal concepts down into understandable terms, into terms that you can have a back and forth with legislators about. I think I would draw on that type of experience. I think that appearing before the legislature in that type of context, appearing before other boards and commissions, is not that dissimilar from appearing in court. And I think having had the experience having to take the law and distill it, and I would argue you have to understand the law better to appear and advocate in those types of contexts than to appear before a judge. Because a judge is going to understand your legal arguments, and legislators, local boards, others may not, and they may not care. So I would rely on that type of experience to, you know, in other situations involving litigation. But like I said, I have worked on a lot of litigation. I think it's typical for not every lawyer who's participated in a case or discussed a case or looked at a draft to have their name on the brief. I mean, you have your name on the brief if you're sort of the primary lawyers on the case. So I would draw on all that experience to fulfill that role as AG.
Thank you, and you are speaking of time when you were an associate at a law firm.
Yeah.
Just moving on to independence from the governor, the role of the attorney general requires that you act as attorney general for all the people of our state. Unlike governor's counsel, you are no longer in the role of representing only the interests of the governor's office. The AG must set aside partisan politics, the importance New Hampshire places on separating the role of AG from partisan politics is evidenced by the fact that in our state, the AG is an appointed official and not an elected official, as is the case in many states, most states. As counsel to the governor, you have served in a partisan role, rightly, for the past 4 years. How can you assure the public that you will set aside politics and act independently as Attorney General?
Yeah, I think to start with answering that question, it just comes down to the basic attorney-client relationship, right? As you mentioned, for the past 4 years, I've been the governor's counsel. So the governor and the governor's office has been my only client. You know, like any other attorney, I take my professional obligations very seriously. As Attorney General, the governor would be one of my clients, but also the council, the legislature, state agencies, the judicial branch, the state as a whole. As Attorney General, I fully understand that I would not be the governor's lawyer, at least not in every context. Sometimes he's a client. I'd be the state's lawyer. So I understand that. I take my obligation seriously, and I start from that premise. I think one of the things I know you and I discussed, and that is important, is that as the Attorney General, you are independent, and you have to be ready when necessary to push back, to say that we can't do something under the law, to say that something is not permissible under the law, and you have to be willing to do that to people who it's not easy to say that to, including the governor. You know, as the governor's counsel, I think sometimes there's a perception that all you do is sort of take what the governor wants to do and implement it. But there are a lot of conversations that happen, you know, inside the office where you're talking through issues. And there are plenty of times when either the governor or others want to do something, and you have to be the one in the room, because you're often the only lawyer in the room, to say, unfortunately, we can't do this. Or, unfortunately, we may be able to do it this way, but we can't do it the way you want to do it. It's not a fun role to play, as you can imagine, to be sort of the killjoy in the room, but I've had to do that. And I think that's prepared me to do that if I'm Attorney General. And I will say that, you know, it's not easy for anyone, or for most people, I would say, to say no or to push back on high-ranking officials, elected or appointed. And I've seen that firsthand. I've been in plenty of meetings with the governor where you can tell it's difficult for someone to say no or to maybe raise a concern. It's not what people want to have to do. They meet the governor, they're in the room with them. It can be tough to do that. I think my experience the last 4 years, having been in those rooms, having had to say that to the governor or other state agency heads, I have experience with that, and I think that actually makes me in a way better placed to do it. Familiarity and a pre-existing relationship with this governor or any governor builds a trust that allows you to stand up and say that something can't be done, or this is wrong, or we've got to do this a different way. I think that's probably part of the reason why throughout New Hampshire history, we've seen a number of governors' legal counsels go on to serve as Attorney General. There's always that kind of issue lingering out there that the governor was your client, now the whole state's your client, can you be independent? And I would say that the AG, the former governor's counsels that have gone on to serve as AGs, did a good job with that. It's been done before, and I feel confident I'll be able to do that.
Thank you. As AG, you will have the responsibility to defend the laws of the state of New Hampshire unless you find them patently unconstitutional. Will you consult with the governor's office in making a determination to defend a particular law?
I think for the core determination as to whether to defend a law, no. At the end of the day, that has to be a decision independently made by the Attorney General. So I think the basic answer to your question is no. What I'm going to build on that a little bit, just because I think it's important for people to understand that at the end of the day, the governor is a client of the Attorney General's office. And if the governor has signed a law, or signed a bill into law that he wants defended, he has an interest in the decision by the Department of Justice as to whether to defend the law. So I think that there will be some conversation that happens sort of around that issue. There has to be. You almost have a duty, I think, to have some communication on the issue. But at the end of the day, I think what you're getting at and what you're asking is whether the decision ultimately to whether to defend the law, will that be made in consultation with the governor or the governor's office? And I think the answer to that is no. That is a decision that needs to be made based on internal analysis of the Department of Justice, based on legal principles, and nothing else.
Thank you. Assuming that you make a determination to defend a law, you will still need to make many strategic decisions during litigation. Decisions about the allocation of resources, both monetary and personnel resources, decisions to appeal lower court rulings, many decisions in litigation along the way. These decisions often have political implications. Will you consult with the governor's office in making these decisions?
Again, I think you have to. If you decided to defend a law, and the governor will be a client in that decision. I mean, the governor at the end of the day has the obligation under the Constitution to execute the laws. And so a case that you're litigating in which you're defending a statute, the governor is one of your clients. The governor has an interest in that case. So I think on litigation strategy and litigation decisions, I think of course we would consult with the governor and with the governor's office. Again, the ultimate decision has to be made by the Attorney General, but consultation there has to happen. I would argue that if you're not consulting with the governor, you're not fulfilling your duty to the governor, who is a client and has an interest in that.
In your role as governor's counsel, you worked closely with legislators on legislative matters, including bills currently pending before the legislature. Will you recuse yourself from defending challenges to laws in which you had involvement while legal counsel to the governor?
I think what I would say, counselor, is in any decision regarding recusal, I would follow the rules of professional conduct and the executive branch ethics code. I don't think it would be appropriate for me, you know, without knowing the specific statute or the facts, to commit to recusing myself from defending a statute just because I worked on it. I think you have to make those decisions on a case-by-case basis. I don't think you can make those commitments just on a blanket basis.
I just want to be clear that I understand that if you've advised and consulted with the legislature, worked on a piece of legislation, you are not committing that you would recuse yourself in that case.
What I'm committing to, counselor, is following the rules of professional conduct. So I would look at the specific piece of legislation, consider my obligations under the rules of professional conduct, consult with the office's general counsel, and make a determination as to whether I need to recuse myself. I imagine there may be instances like you're referring to where I would need to recuse myself, but I just don't think it would be appropriate or responsible to make a recusal commitment on hypothetical situations like that.
Fair enough. If you get an opinion from the Office of General Counsel that you should recuse yourself, would you recuse yourself?
Yes.
The Republican Attorney General's Association, which we also spoke about, is a partisan organization. Most of its members are elected in partisan elections, unlike the appointment process we have here in New Hampshire. In my earlier discussions with Attorney General Gordon McDonald, he advised me that he attended one meeting of this association in 2017, was uncomfortable with the political nature of the organization, and had no further participation. Earlier this year, the policy arm of the Republican Attorney General's Association was found to have paid for robocalls urging participation in the demonstration that resulted in the insurrection on our Capitol on January 6th. Will you commit that you will not participate in this partisan organization during your tenure as AG if conferred.
Yeah, Counselor, as you kind of hit on there, the Attorney General in our state is unique. We're one of only three or four states that doesn't elect our Attorney General. And so in most states, the AG is a partisan elected official. Because of that, the commitment I'm prepared to make is that I will not participate in partisan political activities, so political fundraisers, political events. But as I mentioned when you and I spoke, I think it's important for the Attorney General of our state or any state to network with other AGs, get to know them. And to the extent that there are opportunities like that are provided by the Republican Attorney General's Association that I felt like I could participate in while staying away from the more overt political activities, I would look to do that. You know, I think one of the things I want to do is do some research on what AGs have done in the past. You mentioned Attorney General McDonald. I do believe, for instance, Attorney General Foster participated in some DAGA, Democratic Attorney General Association events and activities. If I'm confirmed, I will speak with other former AGs to get a sense of what their approach was on that. But I think it's important that I not participate in partisan political activities. But I think it is also perhaps, maybe not equally important, but important that I not immediately write off educational or networking opportunities that could ultimately be beneficial to the state.
I assume you don't condone the actions of RAGA in urging people to attend the insurrection.
I do not.
On Tuesday, the Washington Post published an article, "The Republican Attorney General's Threaten Key Element of the $1.9 Trillion Stimulus Bill." According to the article, the Attorneys General take issue, is 21 attorneys general, Republicans, take issue with a $350 billion pot of money set aside under the stimulus known as the American Rescue Plan to help cash-strapped cities, towns, and states pay for the costs of the pandemic. Congressional lawmakers opted to restrict states from tapping these federal dollars to finance local tax cuts. The article states that the plan to reduce business taxes in New Hampshire may be incompatible with the stimulus rules. Have you considered this issue in your potential role as Attorney General? Have you considered whether you would instruct your office to join any lawsuit filed by the Republican Attorney Generals challenging the provision of the American Rescue Plan?
So I've been focused on the nomination process, so I haven't studied this particular issue closely, but I'll say this. Generally, the office employs a screening and review process when considering whether to sign on to cases. And the two questions that they ask, the two primary questions, are whether a case, a lawsuit, implicates the interests of the state of New Hampshire, and whether the lawsuit is inherently political. And those two points are kind of a sliding scale balancing test between those two points. If any case that, you know, the state is asked to sign on to, if I am Attorney General, that implicates the interests of the state of New Hampshire, we would consider signing on to. We would think about whether that embroils us in politics, because it's not a political office, but we would consider it. And I will say, just as a hypothetical, if there were an attempt by the federal government to overreach and restrict our state's elected leaders to make policy decisions, I think that would present some serious constitutional issues, and I think it'd be something we have to look at. At the end of the day, I think the people of our state want to know, when they have elected leaders to represent them at the state level, that we will not let those elected leaders' ability to represent the people be watered down by potential federal government overreach. So I think it could be something worth looking at, but I have not in the past few weeks looked at this specific case closely, and so I can't really tell you whether that's something we would do if I'm Attorney General.
Thank you. Just two more questions.
Excuse me 1 second, please. To be cognizant of our time limits of 30 minutes, we'll allow you to circle back after public testimony. At this point,
Excuse me, Counselor, but we are way ahead of schedule.
You're at a half an hour at this point.
I am not, and we are way ahead of schedule. I have two more questions. The people of District 2 elected me to ask my questions. I'm going to ask my questions. You have appointed yourself to be chairwoman of this. You were not elected. You do not.
We haven't agreed upon time limit, the half an hour, and you were given the ability to circle back at the conclusion of the public portion of questioning. At this point, Mr. Kinney is going to take over. Thank you.
Mr. Kinney, I would ask your permission to let me ask my two final questions.
At this point, I would encourage us to move on. I've asked Mr. Formella for 2 or 3 hours in my community many, many questions, and I would love to ask him more questions. A lot of those questions have already been raised, but in the interest of the time and the public's time, I think we need to move on.
Mr. Gatzes, do you have any questions at this time?
I have no questions.
Thank you. We're ready to queue up for public testimony. Speaking first. Mr. Lynn. Thank you, Mr. Formella.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the council. My name is Bob Lynn. I'm the former Chief Justice of the New Hampshire Supreme Court, and I'm now a representative from Wyndham, which is the subject of the controversy concerning the election results. And I'm really honored to be here to speak in behalf of John Formella. I've known John for, I would say, probably 4 to 5 years since he's been the governor's counsel, and I've had an opportunity to work with him in various capacities, both during the time I was still on the Supreme Court and since that time. And incidentally, I should tell you, John didn't say this, but because he's really a very modest guy, but it's my understanding that one of the people who provided the prime recommendation to Governor Sununu, which resulted in John becoming the governor's counsel, was his a partner in his law firm, Jack Sanders, who was a very prominent Democrat in the state and a wonderful guy, a very, very competent lawyer, who saw, I think, an excellent young associate when he was working with him and made a strong recommendation to the governor to hire John, and that was an excellent move on the part of the governor, for sure. As I said, I've worked with John on a variety of issues, both during the time I was the Chief Justice and also since then in my role as a legislator. It's involved things concerning, for example, when I was still at the court, budget issues regarding funding for the court and that kind of thing, some personnel issues. And since I've been a legislator, proposed legislation. It's clear to me, and I think it was clear to you from John's very thoughtful testimony here earlier, that he is a very, very smart, thoughtful, and fair-minded person. I have no doubt, based upon my discussions with John, that there were occasions when John had to, exercise that kind of lawyerly advice to a governor, or maybe some of you as members of the council, or perhaps legislators, saying, look, I understand what you want to do, or I understand what you like to do, but this is not going to fly, or it's not going to fly in the way you want to do it. And I have no doubt of John's ability to do that, and to do that in a forthright and yet respectful way, in advising whoever that may be, may have occasion to do that with. So I don't have any question whatsoever that John is highly qualified for this position and will be a really great AG. And I guess the last thing that I would say, and this really has nothing to do with John's legal acumen, although he has a tremendous amount of that. It's just, I think it, at a very kind of fundamental level, John is just a very nice guy. He's the kind of guy that any of you would want to go out and have a beer with. And that, I think that probably tells, says more about John than anything else. Thank you very much.
Who's going to be driving?
Pardon?
Who's going to be driving?
Thank you, Justice.
I just said beer. Not a lot of beer.
Commissioner Quinn.
Good morning, Madam Chair, honorable council members. My name is Robert Quinn, and I'm the Commissioner of the Department of Safety. I'm honored to appear before you today in strong support of the nomination of John Formella as the next Attorney General. As Commissioner, I'm responsible for seven divisions: Motor Vehicle, Fire Academy, Emergency Medical Services, Fire Safety, Emergency Communications and Services Administration, and of course, the New Hampshire State Police. I'm in my 36th year working for the Department of Safety, which has truly been an honor. The Department of Safety works closely with the Attorney General's office and relies heavily on a wide range of legal services involving all complex and highly sensitive criminal investigations. In addition, the Department receives our legal representation in civil matters from the office. The office also helps the Department ensure that our actions conform to the Constitution and applicable statutes and administrative rules. As Commissioner, I've had the pleasure of working with John in his role as counsel to the governor on a variety of complex and sensitive matters affecting the department, the state, and the public at large. While I am sure that you will hear many testify to his superior legal skills as his attorney, I would like to speak about the skills that he possesses that are especially important and that, in my humble opinion, make him an excellent candidate for this position. The many issues that I've worked on with John have been mission critical, impacted public safety, and set policies for the state at large. I have always been impressed at how quickly John is able to grasp the intricacies and nuances of each matter before him, no matter how complex or sensitive. He has displayed extreme patience, open-mindedness, and most of all, compassion towards all stakeholders involved. I think that you will agree that these are all traits that are important to having as the leader of the Department of Justice. The Department of Safety is working extremely hard to continually enhance the safety, security, and quality of life in New Hampshire through professional, collaborative, and innovative service to all. This is done by our dedicated employees and the relationships and partnerships that we have grown over the years, one of which is with the Office of the Attorney General. This mission-critical partnership will continue to strengthen with John's confirmation as Attorney General. In closing, there are a few more important relationships in state government than that between the Department of Safety and the Attorney General. I am confident that John will provide the leadership and support that is needed to keep everyone safe. I support his nomination and look forward to working closely with John to make New Hampshire the safest state in the nation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner Quinn. Next, Charles McIntyre.
Good afternoon, members of the council. My name is Charlie McIntyre. My mom called me Charles. I have the privilege of being executive director of financial lottery for the last 11 years. Prior to that, and I'll get the background real briefly, I was a practicing attorney for 20 years. I had been a private attorney in a litigation firm in Boston for 2 years. I had been assistant district attorney for a criminal prosecutor for 7 years in a county, Norfolk County, Massachusetts, which has a population of about 800,000, and I left as the head of the Special Investigations Unit, which is an organized crime. And then I have been in-house counsel for the Masters Lottery for 7 years as well. So I came to New Hampshire with a legal background, which I tend to ignore because it gets in the way of selling tickets. So I've had the privilege to work with John, and I wholeheartedly support his nomination for the past 4 years. And I'll give you one example, just as a brief anecdote. The Justice Department of the U.S., the Attorney General of the United States, changed their opinion related to gambling, a very deep and meaningful change of opinion, literally a 180. And it put at risk the lottery's revenues, some or all of them, depending upon your interpretation. And so, you know, with the next litigator, I got all mad. And called and said, we need to file suit. Now, mind you, this is a Republican administration filing lawsuit against the Republican administration. So, contacted the Attorney General's office, contacted the Governor's office, went through multiple meetings, and we filed suit against the Attorney General of the United States. Web cases won its way through federal court, district court, Concord, New Hampshire. It has been litigated successfully at the First Circuit Court of Appeals in Boston. John was an integral part of that, and both places we prevailed. You may not know about it much, but certainly in our industry, in gambling and lottery, it's one of the seminal cases of our industry. And John was an integral part of it, worked closely with it, worked on every aspect of it. I will tell you, as an ex-litigator, in this context, I'm the chief witness for the government, so it's hard to let someone else fly the plane. I've tried a couple hundred cases to jury. So letting somebody else litigate a case is hard because it's, you know, as a pilot, I'm sure they don't like how other people fly a plane. And I was never let down. It was a great result. Our industry celebrated it. So, John not only is an excellent lawyer, he's an excellent person. And he's never once wavered in what I believe to be integrity. So I support his nomination as the Lottery Commission itself. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. McIntyre. Michelle Kenny. Maturity, Mr. Robinson?
Good afternoon, counselors.
Good afternoon, counselors. My name is Dennis Robinson, and I am privileged to be here in support of John Formella's nomination to be New Hampshire's next Attorney General. I am a lawyer at Pierce Atwood, and have been practicing commercial real estate law in New Hampshire for 27 years. Like my colleagues, Michelle Kenny and Mark Bellarow, I met John when he joined the firm in 2012. I could not agree more with their observations about John's work ethic, character, maturity, and intellect, all of which will serve him well as an Attorney General. I appreciate the opportunity to put some of that in context for you based on my own observations and experiences with John. Over the 4-year period that I worked with John, we collaborated on many projects, some small and some quite large. One of the more memorable for me was our work together on a spin-off by a large global company of its United States real estate assets. The work spanned a year and was quite involved, as Pierce Atwood was lead U.S. counsel for the project. John did not simply support the project. He assumed significant responsibility without being asked and led many parts of it. That included not only coordinating and managing others within the firm, but also coordinating the effort with counsel in many other states. It was quite impressive, more so given that John was only a third-year associate at the time. And I was not the only one who noticed. In-house counsel for the client was truly shocked to learn that John had not been practicing law for many, many years beyond his experience. Even after John left Pierce Atwood to join the governor, we remained in touch and occasionally met for lunch and saw each other at various functions. It was clear to me from our conversations that John was continuing not only to work tirelessly, but that he was also further developing communication and relationship skills that were already exceptional. The role of legal counsel to the governor is a demanding 24/7 job, and John clearly was committed to excelling in that position. The truth is, John will succeed in whatever path his career takes him, but I believe that both John and the state of New Hampshire would greatly benefit if you confirm him as our next Attorney General. I'm going to depart from my written comments to say one additional thing in response to the concern over John's lack of experience in criminal matters. I think you can measure intelligence a few different ways, but I don't measure it necessarily by what you know. I measure it by how quickly you can learn what you don't. And by that standard, John really does not have many equals, and I'm fully confident in his ability to do that for the state. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Robinson. Mr. Bellabar? Any task within any practice group. As a result, he gained experience
exposure and experience in a variety of practice areas. In addition, he sought out opportunities to represent people who could not afford an attorney and successfully assisted a number of clients on a pro bono basis. John's interpersonal skills and ability to connect with clients, whether they are representatives from Fortune 500 companies or individuals seeking reimbursement of their security deposit, engenders a confidence and trust that is essential to the successful practice of law in any leadership position. Some attorneys never develop these skills. For John, they are a natural part of who he is as a person. Early on, John showed a strong commitment to excellence and possessed a desire to grow and develop into an outstanding attorney and responsible citizen. We often spoke about how to make the best use of the finite amount of time we all have in order to efficiently and effectively achieve our goals. John was committed to serving his community and was able to successfully manage a busy law practice with active involvement in a variety of community organizations. When John was presented with the opportunity to serve as legal counsel to the governor, he took time to seriously think about and discuss with his family and colleagues all of the factors one needs to consider when taking on such an important role. John wanted to be sure he could meet the governor's expectations and consider how he might prepare himself for and navigate such a significant new position. While we hate to see John leave Pierce Atwood, we knew he was not only well qualified and had all of the skills to take on such an important and visible role, we knew he was ready to do so. John had the maturity, presence, intelligence, communication, and leadership skills to excel, and I think that his service to the governor and state has proven that true. Having excelled in his current role, the governor and many of the people John has worked with these past 4 years have given their unconditional support for John to serve as the next Attorney General for New Hampshire and lead the New Hampshire Department of Justice. Without reservation, I proudly add my unconditional support to this nomination and encourage that you cast your vote in favor of John to serve as Attorney General for the state of New Hampshire. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bellamy. Charlie Erlinghouse.
Good morning. I'm Charlie Erlinghouse. I'm the Commissioner of Administrative Services for the state. The state didn't used to have a legal counsel. I tell this to...
Should I start over? I'm Charlie Erlinghouse. I'm the Commissioner of Administrative Services. Legal counsel is a relatively new office for the governor in New Hampshire. It's my friend Walter Peterson established it in his second term because he wanted his own lawyer, not his. I talked to him about this once at the Cat and Fiddle over lunch. If you knew Walter, that was where things happened a lot. Marty Gross was the first legal counsel for the state, people know. So we've had 21 people who served as legal counsel. Six of them were appointed Superior Court justices, and four of them have been nominated to be attorneys general. Most recently, obviously, Mike Delaney by John Lynch. Why? Because legal counsel is that kind of role. It's a very different role. It's a very different job than attorney general, but there's probably no experience being a lawyer that prepares you for it quite the same way because you do everything. So I didn't know John before Governor Sununu got elected, and I did a 6-month stint as his interim budget director. Some guy from Portsmouth was his legal counsel. If you know anything about the governor's office, you know it's a dump, right? The worst office space in the state of New Hampshire. It's dreadful. The corner office is okay, where the governor is, not bad. But the rest of it is dreadful. And it's, I mean, people, there was a woman who came in whose husband had worked there, like during the open house they do on the inaugural. She's like, oh my God, what happened? And her husband's like, no, it's always been like this, and apparently. So John and I had desks next to each other in what an amongst an office, although the wall doesn't go to the ceiling or the floor, so I'm not sure that counts. And to get out, I had to like turn my body and like squeeze by his desk to get out. So I got to know him well because we're like right on top of each other. But didn't know him from Adam's off ox before we started.
And, you know, I've got my head down, and, you know, the budget's kind of a big thing when it's happening. And, but observing a lot, and we interacted on a lot, because obviously he does a ton with the budget. House Bill 2 was written by the governor's council, pretty much. A lot of input, but... at the time, there was a whole Met dish kerfuffle, which happens every 2 years, but there was a whole bunch of lawyers who thought they were really powerful, sending threatening, nasty letters to us, which I got to sort of chuckle with him over. And what I observed, though, is John Formella, the person, and his calmness, his work ethic, and his ability to deal with people. And, you know, when I would say, I can't believe you didn't punch that person in the nose, and instead just, like, let them yell at you for 10 minutes. It's part of who he is. It's part of who he was. As commissioner at Administrative Services, we deal with him a lot, not just the council meetings, you know, the council process, which we're both very involved in, but on subjects large and small all the time. And a big part of those meetings involves people saying yes or no, and occasionally me or somebody I work with saying, not sure that's technically the way we do things. And at no point in the process did, he's not the kind of guy who ever said, I'm not suggesting people have ever said this in the past, but I don't care what you think about this, this is what the governor wants. No, we talked about things. He explained things, I explained things, we came to a resolution. Agree, disagree, whatever. But it was professional, and it was people talking to each other and understanding each other. Everyone I know who's dealt with John deals with him that way. When you deal with the governor's office, you think to yourself, did you get Formella or did you get somebody else? And it's, and everybody wants to get Formella as opposed to somebody else. And Jonathan, too, sorry. But basically, that's what it was. You're like, all right, you know what? Until we talk to Formella, it doesn't matter. And that's the way it is, because he worked on everything. I would recommend him to you and to anyone, the qualities that serve you best in running a Department of State Government. Frankly, whether it's, whether you're gonna be the Commissioner of Justice or you're gonna be the Commissioner of Banking or whatever, our judgment, prudence, and our ability to deal with people. And that's who he is. He's one of the most decent, thoughtful, honest people I've ever met. And I say that quite sincerely. And, you know, in politics, that's, there aren't a lot of those. But in addition to that, he has judgment, he has prudence, and he has an incredible work ethic. And if that's not good enough, then nothing is. So, thanks for having me.
Thank you, Mr. Arlen Hess. Martha Dickey?
Good afternoon, Executive Councilors. Thank you for allowing me to speak today on John's behalf. I am in support of John's nomination as Attorney General for New Hampshire. I'm a resident of Boscawen, and I'm very honored to be here today. I first met John 3 years ago, shortly after my son Jason died by suicide at age 19. And by shortly, I mean I was still in mourning, and it was probably not my finest hour to be meeting people. A mutual friend introduced me to Governor Sununu, and John was with him at that first meeting. Together, we all began working on an important piece of legislation relative to suicide awareness and prevention. And during that process, John took on the role as my unofficial guide, and it was a job he did with the utmost respect and dedication. The mission of the Justice Department reads in part to serve the people of New Hampshire with diligence, independence, and integrity. Two of those words immediately strike me and remind me of John: diligent and integrity. John is one of the most diligent people I have met. He is thorough and always provides follow-up. He is a man of integrity who treats others with respect and has always been honest and open with me. I think John has been preparing for this role, this mission, most of his career, and what I've heard here today, I think, solidifies my thoughts. With that in mind, it is my belief that John will look out for the best interests of the people of the state of New Hampshire. I am certain that his legal background and experience will shine as he continues to guide New Hampshire through many important and challenging issues as Attorney General if he is confirmed. To date, these issues have included a pandemic, social unrest, the ongoing opioid crisis, and increasing need for improved and accessible mental health resources. That is where I can personally speak to John's ability and dedication. John kept my family and I informed on the status of the legislation that we worked on together for well over a year. Whenever I reached out to him with a question on process, next steps, or other issues, he always responded to me in a timely manner. It is from John that I learned how a bill gets passed, what engross means, and how to understand ought to pass. John would often accompany me when I testified before the House or Senate. He offered his knowledge and expertise along the way. He stood with me outside of many hearings while I waited for my turn to speak, and he never grew weary of me or my multitude of questions. His knowledge and expertise on the process of getting legislation passed proved invaluable to me and kept me sane through the process. As a citizen of New Hampshire, I look forward to John's confirmation to the Attorney General's office, and I thank you for your time and your service to the state of New Hampshire.
Thank you, Ms. Dickey.
Thank you.
Scott O'Connell? Thank you, Mr. O'Connell. I'd like to pause for just one moment.
Good afternoon, members of the council. Thank you for the opportunity for me to speak in support of the nomination of Attorney John Formella to serve as the next Attorney General for the state of New Hampshire. My name is Mary Tan. I'm a trial lawyer, and I have my own firm in Manchester. I've been a lawyer for more than 25 years. I've been actively involved in the bar serving both as president of the Manchester Bar Association and the statewide New Hampshire Bar Association. I currently serve as chair of the Board of Bar Examiners, and I also serve on the board of the New Hampshire Bar Foundation. Over the course of my career in New Hampshire, I have had the opportunity and the privilege to represent clients in courtrooms throughout the state and to work with attorneys and judges statewide. And today I'm so pleased that you've had the opportunity to hear from many about Attorney Formella's legal skill, his strategic judgment, and his leadership qualities. All traits that John has demonstrated, in my view, in abundance in his law practice, and most recently in his role as legal counsel to the governor during the largest public health crisis in the last century. His legal training at Pierce Atwood and his experience, in my view, amply qualify him to lead the Department of Justice. However, I would like to speak with you today about a more personal view of Attorney Formella. I first met John in 2018, and we occasionally crossed paths at various legal events. The legal community in New Hampshire still remains small. Shortly thereafter, we both had parents fighting cancer, but neither of us knew then of the other's concern. Eventually, we learned. For John, it was his mother. For me, my dad. And for those of you who have been touched by cancer in your life, whether individually or with a loved one, you know that the disease is at best challenging and can take from us those we love in a very cruel way. When all of the advances of science and the powers of modern medicine fall short and offer no hope, there are days when the weight of the concern seems unbearable. In those days, you learn a lot about yourself and about others on that same journey. John and I shared our experiences over the past years, and sadly, what would come to be our respective losses. Never one to complain, John met the challenge with empathy and with grace, focused on others. Sustained by his faith, John was fully present as his mother battled the disease. I was impressed by his strength in those moments and often said to myself, could I be as strong? John's mother eventually passed away shortly before the pandemic struck. And at a time when everybody in the world would have understood if John stepped aside to focus on himself, he did just the opposite. He dug in. He confronted and managed the complex legal issues, giving strategic counsel in the midst of a pandemic and addressing the many legal issues that emerged in what we all know was a fractious 2020 election year. In all of that, John made the time to reach out repeatedly, knowing firsthand the road ahead for me and for my family. I share this very personal insight with you about Attorney Formella because, in my view, it exemplifies the lawyer I have come to know, but more importantly, what our state can expect from him as Attorney General. To be sure, he has broad legal experience and a mature judgment. But more than that, when the going gets tough, he can be counted on to meet the challenge head on, with purpose, with determination, and importantly, with a genuine concern for others. I have every confidence that John will bring all of these skills to his work at the Department of Justice, and I respectfully urge his confirmation as New Hampshire's next Attorney General. Thank you very much for allowing me to speak with you today.
Thank you, Ms. Ten. We have Diane Martin calling in.
Good afternoon. My name is Diane Martin, and I am currently the chairwoman of the Public Utilities Commission. I'm proud to be here to support the nomination of John Formella for the Attorney General. As a former longtime member of the New Hampshire Attorney General's office, having served there in many roles, and ultimately as Associate Attorney General and Chief of Staff, I know firsthand just how important the work of the Department of Justice is. The workload is heavy, and the matters handled touch the lives of every citizen of New Hampshire. The people who work there are some of the hardest working, most dedicated folks I have ever met. For those reasons, the qualities of the person who leads that office are critically important. I have had the opportunity to work closely with John Formella since he began state service. I have worked with him on significant legal issues, and he has demonstrated the qualities that are essential to the job of Attorney General. Those qualities include fairness, being hardworking, having expertise in the law, and importantly, being able to understand and apply diverse laws, because at the Attorney General's office, there is no regular day. Every day brings new issues, and you have to be able to quickly learn and apply different laws. I have observed all of these qualities in John Formella, but the most important quality John brings to the job is his ability to work with people who have very diverse views and find resolutions to complex issues. His calm and respectful demeanor will be an asset to him in the role of Attorney General and to the state of New Hampshire with him leading the Department of Justice. I am also very excited for my former colleagues to have a new leader who will be respectful of them and will work with them as part of the team. And for all of these reasons, I am very proud to support the nomination of John for Attorney General. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Martin. Chief Hobeck?
Madam Chairwoman, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Madam Chairwoman and members of the Executive Council, my name is Joseph Hobecki, and I serve as the Chief of Police in Hollis, New Hampshire. I've been in law enforcement since my 20th year, and today it's my honor to speak in support of Mr. John Formella's nomination as Attorney General for the state of New Hampshire. I do so having had the privilege of working closely with Mr. Formella over the past several months.
Thank you, Chief Abecky. Melissa St. Cyr on the line. Thank you, Ms. Sincere. Ken Norton?
Honorable members of the Executive Council, thank you for the opportunity to speak in support of the nomination of John Formella as Attorney General. My name is Kenneth Norton. I live in Tulsa, and I serve as the Executive Director of Nominee for the National Alliance on Mental Illness. I've also served as a member of Governor Sununu's School Safety Task Force, and more recently on the Governor's Law Enforcement Accountability Community and Transparency, the lead prosecuted and the role of the Office of the Chief Medical Examiner plays in determining suicide and drug overdose deaths. Having an attorney general who has familiarity and understanding of these issues will be helpful if we work our way through this crisis. On behalf of Mountain New Hampshire, I ask you to support John's nomination for attorney general, and I thank you for the opportunity to testify.
Thank you, Mr. Norton. Next up, Lindsay Courtney. Good afternoon, members of the council. My name is Lindsay Courtney. I'm currently the executive director of the Office of Professional Rights Insurance Certification. Prior to that, I served at the Attorney General's Office as litigation counsel to the Department of Health and Human Services. I've had the pleasure of working with John Formella for several years in both capacities. I fully support his nomination and wish to thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today. As legal counsel to Governor Sununu, John was certainly an integral part in resolving several DHHS cases of which I was a part, including many very difficult DCYF cases involving psychiatric boarding that were challenging from both a legal and factual standpoint. And working with Attorney Formella on litigation matters, I found that he was able to quickly learn and master new areas of the law. He was decisive, while at the same time seeking and valuing the input of others. And he understood that while the state may have the ability to press certain arguments at certain times, it's not always in the public's interest to always do so. I have observed John to always act in the public's best interest. In my capacity as executive director, I work closely with Attorney Formella to resolve a number of issues impacting our state. One that comes to mind is the Medicaid disclose issue. That was one of the first issues I worked on with going over to the office. When Medicaid reimbursement schools became threatened, John's leadership, coordination of efforts, collaboration with others, and work with stakeholders permitted the state to find a solution to ensure that children continue to receive the services they need in the schools. And that was something that really struck me as we were going through this process, that it was never a doubt about whether the kids would continue to receive services. It was always about how we're going to find the way to make it happen. His leadership skills are remarkable. And this was certainly made clear to me during COVID-19. Immediately following Governor Sununu's declaration of the state of emergency over about a year ago. Attorney Formella worked to establish a process essentially overnight to ensure that the state could modify regulations in order to respond to the COVID-19 pandemic and make sure its constituents continued to receive vital services. So for my own agency, this meant we had a number of changes that were quite important to me, but also to a large sector of the population. It meant changes to laws pertaining to public meetings so that our boards and obviously the council could continue to meet remotely, permitting telehealth for all professions, health professions, to promote the continuity of care for our citizens, establishing an emergency licensing process to allow healthcare providers to respond to the COVID-19 pandemic, permitting pharmacists and other providers to administer COVID-19 vaccines, allowing military service members and EMTs to assist with the COVID-19 response. It could have been really chaotic, especially at the beginning. And with John's quick thinking and his leadership skills and how he coordinated the efforts from an executive branch standpoint, I'm very happy to say it was not chaotic, and I'm very proud of the way New Hampshire responded. John's quick work, ability to collaborate with others, and development and implementation of a plan permitted New Hampshire to rise to the challenge this past year. John is undoubtedly certified or qualified to serve as Attorney General. In addition, I've just found him a really true joy and pleasure to work with. He is always available, which is wonderful as a client, and he's willing to listen and happy to assist. I very much look forward to continuing to work with him, and I urge your support of his confirmation. Thank you very much. Thank you, Ms. Courtney. Patrick Collins.
Good Good afternoon. My name is Patrick Collins. I'm a trusted estates attorney and live in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. John and I are close friends. He was the officiant at my wedding, and we are former colleagues at Pierce Atwood. And I'd like to spend just a couple minutes describing John, the lawyer, and John, the person, as a strong supporter of his nomination to be Attorney General. Few people can wield the skills and temperament necessary to be a great lawyer, along with the innate personality traits that make someone a great person. John Formella is one of those rare few. As a lawyer, John is practical, articulate, and laser-focused, while still being detail-oriented, approachable, and compassionate. Whether working on pro bono eviction cases or high-stakes land use and business deals, John brought the same level of professionalism and passion to all of his work at Pierce Atwood. He was a rising star and on the fast track to partnership before Governor Sununu recognized his talents and plucked him out of private practice to be his legal counsel. Having served in that role for the past 4 years, the governor's nomination and endorsement of John as New Hampshire's 32nd Attorney General should tell you all you need to know about John's legal abilities and the incredible job he did competently serving the multitude of legal needs for the governor. As a person, John may be young, but he's the oldest 34-year-old I know. I generally think of myself as leading a pretty straight and narrow life, but compared to John, I'm considered a bad influence. John is a devout Catholic, he's an avid reader, and he works every day to honor his recently deceased mother's memory by living with a genuine sense of humility and selflessness. And I can't imagine how proud she'd be here today, listening to all these great things people have to say about him. Even despite being nominated to such an esteemed position at a relatively young age, John does not have glorified airs or a ballooned ego. He's grounded and modest, and you don't have to worry about salacious controversies with John Formella at the helm. He's fiercely ethical, decent, and will serve with great integrity. Probably the most famous Attorney General in New Hampshire history is Justice David Souter. At his confirmation hearing to be an Associate Justice on the United States Supreme Court, he provided the following as a reflection of his years of service as a New Hampshire jurist. The first lesson, simple as it is that whatever court we're in, whatever we're doing, at the end of our task, some human being is going to be affected. Some human life is going to be changed by what we do. And so we better use every power of our minds and our hearts and our beings to get those rulings right. John Formella shares the same sense of empathy and will fervently devote his mind, his heart, and his being to getting it right in everything he does as Attorney General. I can think of no better person or qualified lawyer to lead the Department of Justice, and I urge you to vote in favor of John Formella as our next Attorney General. Thank you.
Mr. Collins. Lynn Shallon.
Good afternoon, counselors. My name is Lynn Shallette, and I'm the Executive Director of New Hampshire Global Achievement and Active Intellectual Arts, which is an umbrella organization for 13 community-based nonprofit crisis centers that serve approximately 15,000 victims of domestic and sexual violence each year. And here is our enthusiastic support for the Governor's nomination of John Formella as Attorney General. Thank you for this opportunity. The coalition has had the opportunity to work closely with Mr. Formella on a number of projects during his time as legal counsel to the governor. Most recently, he spearheaded efforts on behalf of governor community to work with the coalition to ensure that victims of domestic violence had access to emergency shelter and other support during the early days of the pandemic. Mr. Formella fully understood the importance of developing safety nets for victims and for children who were trapped in homes with abusers, and he acted quickly to help coordinate this response. This effort was unprecedented and was, as you can imagine, especially challenging, and it required creative solutions to leverage state federal resources. Mr. Formella showed great strategic leadership during this time to ensure that no victims were left without the resources to achieve the safety they needed for themselves and for their children. Mr. Formella has also worked closely with the coalition staff to strengthen several policies and laws in New Hampshire to advance and uphold the legal rights of victims of crime. Mr. Formella is well known for being collaborative. You've heard from a lot of other witnesses today, he has a gift for bringing people together to identify and generate
Greg Moore.
Thank you, members of the council, for giving the opportunity to speak in support of the nomination of John Formella for Attorney General. In particular, I'd like to hear Councilor Wheeler. I'm glad that they leave on the way to a full recovery. For the record, my name is Greg Moore, and I'm speaking today in my personal capacity. I first met John about 6 or 7 years ago, this is before he was involved in public service. Before then, he was a young top shoveler who was a good guy. Now, I can tell you, I've heard that exact description about several people, but John is a rare example of where it's true. Upon meeting John, I was really happy to be a shoveler in mind. He was keenly aware of the dynamic of drive public policy, the intersection of the legal system and the policy making process, which impressed me greatly since then. It's been over the last few years. It's quite grasp of complex and complicated concepts that run through the state government and drive policy outcomes and how it affects the application of law. John is an incredibly quick study who will be able to move to the Department of Justice quickly and be very effective. Much like a former commissioner I used to work for a few years ago at the Department of Health and Human Services, John will also continue an important transformation at the Department of Justice. That department was led by former DOJ staff, which many years, and I believe it's John Kingsford. Thankfully, the last two attorneys general, Joe Foster and Linda Donald, were outsiders who brought much needed transparency and fresh thinking to the department. John will continue these efforts to help to ensure that DOJ becomes more customer focused and responsive to the public. Additionally, John knows state government really well. He understands the executive branch, that built strong relationships with legislative branches who report. And I'm sure that the former three former state senators and the council member having relationships with the legislation is critical to protect any department head. Some commissioners never know what number they ultimately have undermined their ability to be effective in their roles. Finally, I know John understands the importance of the council and truly respects your role in state government. This is also critical since the Attorney General serves the council for you. And having somebody you can work with and trust is significant to being successful. I know John will work to maintain that relationship. Well, I can go on and have additional experience in the last day of July. I think he'd be great. I know that there are a number of other people waiting this week, so I'll leave it at that and how did you do that? Approve the nomination of John Formella as Attorney General. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Moore. Mr. Haas.
Good afternoon. I'm in no rush. I would like to hear the two questions that Councillor Warmington was going to ask so that I may reply to maybe those two, because she did ask a nice question that I want to comment on the first time.
Well, we were going to finish up public questions and comments and then go back to executive council members. So if you'd like to speak, this is your opportunity.
So in other words, if I can't talk later after that, I will send you a written reply. Is that the procedure?
Certainly.
Okay. Thank you. Joe Haas, Gilmanton. Good to see a newbie being the chairman, Madam Chairman. I sent you some more emails, and I won't refer to those, just my notes for today. And I do appreciate my executive counselor, Warmington, asking about attending the Republican Attorney General Association. And what it gets into, I heard the answer. It was nice that he would go there like for an informational purpose, sort of like continuing legal education. So that was one thing that came to mind, was as an attorney, I think there's a court rule that says they have to have continuing legal education, so many credits per year. So that would be a question that you all should ask him if he's in compliance with that rule. And I did ask Councillor Wheeler ahead of time if he would ask the question, and he said no on the 311-6. He wasn't here the last time I talked to you. I said, well, that ought to be standard operating procedure that when an attorney sees a wrong in the courtroom or the court clerk's office, he's to report that to the judges so that it may be reformed. And that, you know, he can voluntarily answer that if he'd like, but I just thought it would be nice of you all to ask that question to all candidates in the future. And I see your name, Chairman, in the newspaper saying that you're for him, so I presume this is sort of like a show cause hearing why he should not be appointed. So I'm here to present some information that I signed up in advance. But what I do is I tell the candidates that it's really a stepping stone, that I would like things to be done, and then they would be appointed. And I make the reference to just what I said to Gordon McDonald before he became the Attorney General. I said, one of the first things you gotta do is take a whip, you know, not physically, but to, on Benjamin J. Agati, he's in the homicide. What he does when I file private prosecution and criminal complaints against public servants for official oppression, RSA 643:1, he goes in and scribbles his name, dismissed by non-pros at these court clerk's offices, or he calls, like up in Grafton County, if you want to drive up there, he instructed the woman county attorney to sign. And what I'm getting at is this, I've been numbering these speakers. I'm speaker number, 19. It was Patrick Collins, number 16. He made a mention of David Souter. I've been citing him for years and years. The non-pros policy, well, not policy, it's RSA 6:7. It says they do have that right to do that. But by case law, David Souter says you have to examine the evidence, have examinations, plural, of the evidence, which I interpret as, well, in the Attorney General's office, they look at it, then they go to court, and the judge looks at it, and then it's dismissed by no process, there's no case. But what's going on here is there's a block that he just goes in and dismisses by no process. That's the guy. And so that would be one of the first things that I would have him do, is to look into that policy that's violating Judge Souter's case law. And I say that because it's this country is supposed to be to serve and protect. But what's going on is this, it's to serve and protract. That all of these complaints that I have, I make a mention here, it says in his letter of application. The primary job of an attorney is to solve problems for those we represent. The problems still exist. By dismissing a case by null pros, it never gets to the root of the problem. Was I right or wrong? Yes or no? Did the person I charged with the 594:14 summons, how to get him into there, am I right or wrong? Did he or she do wrong? Yes or no, the judge, you know, that's why we have judges. And one last thing is, I make a mention of the last sentence there in paragraph 32, I've already talked about that. On his resume, it says, in the legal experience, the first dot of six, it says legal issues. And then, in the last doc, number six, it says legal compliance with efforts for the governor's office. I mean, you ought to look into not just legal. Legal is statute. Constitution is law. So when it's in the Constitution to do certain things, the governor is Article 51, charged with execution of the laws of the state and the United States. And I won't get into the United States part. I mean, I talked to you about that last time. On the four Congress people we have.
Mr. Hunts, I just want you to be cognizant of your time. We're hoping to cap comments
sure.
for 10 minutes, and you're halfway through. So if you...
Well, I think that's mostly it. One last thing. The word fraud came up, that he's working for the victims of fraud. I mean, that's nice for him to say that, but the people that are in there now, let's get back to this thing. He says all the Department of Justice, or at the Department of Justice, I can say without hesitation from personal experience, the department has many dedicated, talented, and energetic attorneys and staff that are in public service for the right reasons. It would be my honor to join them in their efforts. But as far as fraud, they're not dealing with fraud. I've complained to the Secretary of State's office. There's Eric Forcier. I don't know if you've dealt with him. I think he's retired now. But on my case, I found...
Mr. Hans, you're here to speak in either for or against the nomination of Mr. Formella.
Okay, he said he's for policy rather than practice. He has very little practice, but he has a good policy to set these things up. That's what I would like for him to do, is on fraud. Constructive fraud is when you're going through a sheriff sale. If your property sells at less than a percentage of value, it was Judge Nakos, he says in one guy's case years ago, 25%. In his case, it was a Texas case, 33%. My property sold at a nickel on the dollar. And that should shock the conscience of the court. But a lot of these judges, they don't have any conscience. They get in there, just like Sununu's father. He nominated and put through James D. O'Neill III. And even the Bar Association said, well, don't appoint the guy, he's lousy. And so here I'm seeing, hopefully not similar activity. The phrase was, we plucked him out. Plucked him out of what? Is there a group of attorneys that Sununu chose from? Is that what's going on here, or what? I mean, there's a selection committee. They select. I mean, who he comes in first? Who comes in second? Do you have a choice? I mean, is that person up for a judgeship next time? I have no idea. It would be nice to have, A, B, C, or D to choose. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Haas. If there are any callers on the phone on the line at this point, if you'd like to speak, press 5-star. With that said, our public testimony is over at this point. Mr. Gatzes? Ms. Warmington?
Sure. Thank you, Attorney Formella, for coming back up.
Absolutely.
I certainly wanted to have an opportunity for you to end on a question about your vision going forward. Before I get there, I had one quick question for you. Can you please state your position about making the Lori list public?
Yeah, it's, as you and I talked about when we spoke, the Lori list is a long-standing issue. I've had, over the last few years, many conversations with law enforcement and community stakeholders about it. One of the recommendations of the Lee Act Commission is to make the Lori list public, but on condition that there be a process both to address officers who are currently on the list, who may not ever have had due process, and for future officers that may go on the list, to ensure that there is a set-out process before they go on the list. The department has supported that recommendation. The governor supports that recommendation, and I would work to try to bring both sides together and try to get to a point where we can get to a resolution of the pending litigation that sort of fits within that recommendation. I think both sides are making progress, and I think we've got a good prospect of getting there, but that's my position.
Mm-hmm. You present an interesting dilemma for me as an executive counselor who is in the role of being in the position of having to evaluate whether nominees are qualified for the positions they're nominated to serve. You bring so many, and we've heard here today so much testimony, of wonderful personal qualities, of intelligence, of honesty, of integrity, forthrightness, that I think would be really positive and a real step, step for the Attorney General's office that would be very beneficial to the state of New Hampshire. You also bring to the position, this is the dilemma, of course, you come to the position as the only person ever nominated to serve in this position with no real civil or criminal litigation experience. And it leaves me, I have to tell you honestly, an undecided, but very impressed executive counselor. I will take everything I've heard today into consideration in making a final decision about my vote. And I want to say how much I appreciate the testimony I've heard today from others and also from you. My final question is just about your vision for the department. When we spoke about changes, you indicated that you would like to make a change, some changes that would make the department more consumer-focused. Can you just talk a little bit about that?
Absolutely. Thank you for that, Counselor. One of my experiences with the department over the past 4 years has been, and I don't think this is not to disparage anyone at the department, I just think it's been an approach that the department's had for a long time, is that it can be difficult sometimes for the public to interact with the department. And I spoke about that a little bit in my opening remarks with regard to trying to create better avenues for people to communicate their concerns to the department, to get feedback, to perhaps get some guidance. One thing that attorneys at the department try to be very careful with is not to give legal advice when it's not appropriate to give legal advice. But I think the department could work, and this is something I would really want to make a priority if I'm Attorney General. The department could work to create more opportunities to either provide broadly applicable guidance to the public or to create a little bit more of a constituent service component at the department. What I'd like to look at potentially doing is designating two or three people to who will, they might be attorneys, but will at least be responsible for taking the lead role in taking in citizen inquiries and coming up with a system by which we either have some guidance available that we can give or that we have a system by which we can refer citizens to resources. We've heard a lot in the governor's office over the last 4 years that sometimes people will struggle with the department. They call, they ask a question, the response is, you know, we can't give you legal advice, sorry. Please go speak with the governor's office of constituent services or another state agency. And I think we could just do a little bit better job of being more responsive to citizens' concerns. So that, kind of the way you put it, I'd like to make it a little bit more consumer friendly, so to speak. At the end of the day, it is the people's law firm. And if someone calls the department, they need to feel like they've been listened to and not just, say, passed to another agency or resource because of a little bit of a fear of not giving an appropriate legal advice.
Thank you. I appreciated it when you told me that, and I wanted you to have the opportunity to share that. Thank
Absolutely.
I have a final comment.
Yeah.
We've discussed the accomplishment made by the Environmental Protection Bureau, along with multi-state class action suits. And often it's necessary to go in to file a complaint and to head into court. However, there are occasions where it's necessary to approach this in a tempered manner and to approach it at the bottom of the arsenal, so to speak. We've watched here in New Hampshire on environmental issues where other states such as Connecticut, New York, Vermont have been very aggressive, and it has worked against them. Those guilty have essentially stopped cooperating. They have not extended water lines, for example. We know the approach is often, let's start at the bottom level, let's start at the administrative level and proceed forward. We don't necessarily have to go out there guns blazing. You've been forthcoming discussing your experience with criminal and civil litigation. What we do know is that we have outsourced much of our work here in the state, and it's been necessary and it's been money well spent. I'm confident that you can perform this role. One thing that has come forth through all my discussions, We need someone who's not going to respond in a knee-jerk manner, and who's also going to be a team player. You have a wonderful department with the Department of Justice, and continuity is very important. So I thank you.
Thank you, Counselor.
That concludes today's hearing.
Thank you.
It's just quiet. Yeah. Thank you. You drink. And then.
Decision's coming out any day now.
Be safe.